louder. I'm the last speaker. You can afford to give me a good applause. आपने बाकी सब लोगों के लिए ताली बजाई है. कभी अपने आप के लिए ताली बजाई है? I want you to close your eyes. Close your eyes. And for a moment, please imagine all the small and big struggles. Ma'am, please close your eyes. All the small and big struggles that you go through in life, every day, every year, in your life, all till now. Has anyone given you an award for it ever? For the personal struggles, for the hiding, for the scare that we have inside ourselves, and we come out, we show ourselves, we show up, we anyways present ourselves to our lives. Has anyone given you an award for it? So close your eyes, consider yourself a judge, and consider your own self the receiver of an award. And now I want you to clap for your own self, personally, just for you. बस इतना सा अवार्ड अपने लिए. कम ऑन गाइज, यू कैन डू बेटर देन दैट. सफरिंग इज रिडंडेंट लाइक एन आउटडेटेड सॉफ्टवेयर ऑन अ कटिंग एज मशीन. यू एंड आई आर द कटिंग एज मशीन एंड सफरिंग इज एब्सोल्यूटली यूजलेस. इट्स टोटली यूजलेस बिकॉज इट्स लाइक अ वायरस. A virus, what does a virus do? It takes your software, you're supposed to accomplish something with that software, and the virus only lets you distract yourself from what you were supposed to do in the first place. So virus is just like a distractor, and suffering is that kind of virus in your life. Now according to me, suffering is redundant. Decoding suffering. Since humanity was born, whenever it was born, we have been decoding suffering. We have been trying to understand what is suffering. The most famous seeker, do you know the most famous seeker who went out to find the root cause of suffering? Well, it is written here. So Buddha, he went out, for years he searched, and he found his answer in just one night. So many years of research, one night, the night of his enlightenment, for which he is famous. I, in my words, call it the night he attained absolute clarity. Buddha proposed detachment. He said, if you are attached, you suffer. I, for 21st century, propose absolute clarity. It is obvious that we haven't taken Buddha seriously. You can see in our lives how attached we are. Can we imagine being detached from our families, from our passion, from our work? Not really. So we are so detached, we cannot use that philosophy. What can we use for 21st century? Absolute clarity. That's what we can use for 21st century. Why can we use absolute clarity? Because according to me, it's not the attachments that cause you trouble. It is the unclear dynamics within an attachment that cause you trouble. Say for example, a child is being sexually abused by a relative. What happens to the child? The relative is the safe relationship in which the child can feel safe and express safely. But when a relative abuses the child is confused because there is unclear dynamics within the relationship. Somewhere the child is supposed to feel safe, that is exactly where the child is being violated. So what caused the suffering? The attachment, that is the relationship, or the unclear dynamics within that relationship? Now apply this to everything in life. It is not the relationships, it is not the work, it is not the struggle of life that causes trouble to us, that gives us heartache. It is the unclear dynamics everywhere that give us the heartache. Those who become clear, they transform their destiny. They change the society. They even bring a revolution to the prevalent paradigms. But you may not be ready for it yet. You may not agree with me that suffering is redundant, because in this paradigm, we glorify suffering. How many times have you heard of some rich kid doing something and you have felt that their achievement is hollow and empty because they got everything on a silver plate, right? And how many times do you glorify someone who has suffered and suffered and suffered and then achieved something? Not only do we celebrate this kind of achievement, we even venerate it. We talk about it. We exemplify it. Are you exemplifying achievement or are you exemplifying suffering? In this paradigm, we exemplify suffering. Absolute clarity is the antidote to suffering. You know how I found out? I used to be an extremely ill child. Already as a toddler, my body could not catch up with the thoughts and the speed of the thoughts that I had. I used to think too much for my age. I was a toddler and my neurologist, the ones that my parents went to at that point of time, had to sedate my mind a little bit so my body could catch up. Finally, my body caught up, as you can see now. But what happened was later I got chronic asthma. So a congested chest, not being able to breathe, not being able to talk to anyone, not being able to play freely, not being able to eat tasty food, not being able to communicate what I wanted was what my life was. And in one such moment, in one such asthmatic attack, I was at the verge of a collapse, and thank God, God bless my mother, who intuitively looked behind and reached out to me. As usual, we were rushing for an emergency in some nearby clinic. But before we stepped outside, she looked at my face and she said, "Gesu, for once, just for once, can you get out of this disease on your own without going to the doctor?" I was 14 years old then. I was just a teenager. I don't know what happened to me. I don't know the power that spoke through her. I closed my eyes just to be able to make out some sense out of what she was asking me to do. As soon as I closed my eyes, I was transported to an inner landscape which was timeless and crystal clear. In this timelessness, I could see my disease and I could see the way out. And obviously, I chose the way out. It was only a few minutes when I opened my eyes. My chest was relaxed, my breathing was normal, my muscles were totally fine, and I had a smile on my face. Within a few minutes, I had left my 14-year-old chronic asthma behind. I never had asthma after that. This space, this timelessness is absolute clarity. And many of us have gone through this, maybe in a bigger form, maybe in a smaller form, but what we have done is avoided it, negated it, not believed it, distrusted it. For me, this episode only triggered more hunger. I wanted to know more. And as if the universe was listening, I got some books and Dr. Carl Pribram's book on holographic brain. I don't know what the title is now. Before I could find any kind of linearity in my worldview, my mind was already blown away by the quantum leadership of some of the cutting-edge thought leaders out there. I could not become linear anymore in my life. Absolute clarity is an inside business. You know where it takes place? In your navel. Navel is the first port of contact between the universe and the form, the structure, right? In Hindu mythology, in the Vedas, it is the navel through which Brahma was born. Not the mind, not the heart. And there is a reason for it. Because at the navel is absolute clarity. This absolute clarity, which I experienced at the age of 14, and kept going back into the experiences where this entire phenomenon was revealed to me. But I'm not going to go into that topic here in this talk. That is for you to find out later on. Why do I call it an inside business? Because at your navel is your direct connection with the universal intelligence. Now, universal intelligence is not your and mine borrowed intelligence, conditioned intelligence, educated intelligence. It's not that. It is the universal intelligence that has made everything from stars to a grain of sand. everything from Higgs boson to whatnot, to dark matter. That intelligence and you, the form, you are directly connected. No agents required. But at birth, when the umbilical cord is cut, there is an energetic jerk that takes place at the navel, dislodging your connection with the universal intelligence. Now, instead of being these empowered beings who can take a direct decision based and connected with universal intelligence, what do we become? Sorry to put it this way, beggars. Because now we look outside for clarity. Where do you look for clarity? Where do you look for guidance? Where do you ask for advice? Outside of you, whoever it is, however well-intentioned they are. But it is outside of you. It's not inside. And where is the universe? It's inside of you. Where is intelligence? It's inside of you. When you feel an emotion, where do you feel it? Inside or outside? When you feel love, when you feel sexuality, when you feel jealousy, when you feel anger, does the universe feel it? Do others feel it? Or do you feel it? It's me. If I feel everything, all the emotions, then why not absolute clarity too? So I am the holder of absolute clarity. And that is my connection, the source, whatever it may be for you, each one of you. But at birth, this connection is damaged and severed very badly. And for the rest of our lives, we are looking outwards for clarity. And this creates a very deep exhaustion in us. We become tired, wounded. You don't have to imagine constantly asking for other people's validation and approval. What does that mean? Most of us who are sitting here know exactly what it means, because we have designed our lives to suit our societal parameters. We want to be liked. We want to be loved. And so we make a lot of inside compromises. And these compromises cost us, because we become exhausted. So the real violence in the world is not outside. The bombs exploding, the wars taking place. It's not that. It is the exhaustion within me. The tiredness within me, between my gut, my heart, and my mind. I'm constantly battling between three different energies within my own self about one single issue. Absolute clarity is nine-dimensional. From the age of 14, and today I'm 40, there have been many heartaches, there have been many illnesses, and every one of them have pulled me into a vortex of suffering. And ironically enough, every suffering created more absolute clarity. So what I came to know is that absolute clarity is not a few epiphanous moments you have here and there, a little bit of advice here and there, a little bit of awakening because of meditation or something else here and there. No. Absolute clarity is nine-dimensional, and it rests in your navel. Why and how? That cannot be spoken in this talk. But nine dimensions, and I'm going to list here for you only the four advantages of stepping into the nine-dimensional absolute clarity. The four advantages are no fear of the future. All of us sitting here, why are we racing like a racehorse? Simply because we are so afraid of the future. What is it going to bring us, right? Are we afraid of the future, or are we worried about the future because we think we are unprepared? Or are we worried about the future because we just don't know what it's going to bring? It's the fear of the unknown. A classic fear is the fear because we are unclear. Again, clarity comes into the picture. So imagine having no fear of the future, being present to the now, and having no burden of the past. Imagine absolute emotional clarity. Like I said in the other example, it's the unclear dynamics within the relationships that cause suffering. Imagine total trust in yourself. Can you for a moment imagine? You don't have to ask anything to anybody whatsoever. You have total trust in yourself. in that case, you will have healthy boundaries with people. In that case, you will have nurturing relationships, because what is not nurturing to you, you won't tolerate it. Because you trust yourself. You are needed by yourself. You don't depend on anyone else. Ubuntu. It's an African term for collective compassion. We all talk about how we hurt each other. We all talk about competition. If we talk about modern life, then we know that competition is the greatest problem of modern life. Severe competition, especially in developing countries like India. Imagine if it is replaced by social benevolence. You are benevolent to me, I am benevolent to you, and we cannot together think of hurting each other. Can you imagine a paradigm like that? Creative actualization. How many of us here go and work in 9-to-5 office and then pursue our passions? The natural talents, gifts, skills given by the universal intelligence to us take a second seat for most people. First is survival. Now imagine a society, imagine a life where your creativity is actualized, where your creativity, your talent is the first priority. And that passion is turned into a life that also earns you the money, that also helps you survive beautifully. Now, as cliched as it sounds, I want world peace. But peace is not a goal. If we could achieve peace as a goal, all the efforts that we have been making at small and large levels, we would have been peaceful as a world by now. But we are not even peaceful within our own families, within our own selves. How do we have peace? Because peace is not a goal, you cannot attain it. Peace is a natural byproduct of absolute clarity. How many times do you see people who are at peace with themselves? As ma'am rightly pointed out, when you accept yourself, you find peace. But peace cannot be attained. It is a byproduct. And today, your and my choices, the most insignificant choices, are shaping tomorrow. Today, when I pick up a plastic straw to put in my coconut water, it is affecting the future of millions of kids tomorrow. Today, the clothes that you and I are using, as it was rightly pointed out by the earlier speakers, the choices that we are making today are designing our planet tomorrow. If we are heading for disaster, it is not somebody else doing it, it is all of us together doing it. So for peace, you and I individually need to have absolute clarity within ourselves. And each individual with absolute clarity will become a collective absolute clarity. So, at the end, we assume that suffering is absolutely necessary. We prepare our kids, we school our kids to face the adversities of life. We save for a rainy day. We have weapons stored in where for some war which will happen someday, but we don't have food for so many people who go hungry in the night. We create suffering as the basic template of our life. We assume that this is the template, and on this template we have to build success. Can you imagine that we prepare for the worst, but comically enough expect the best? Isn't it amusing? And for most of you, many of you, it will come across as very odd, because all our lives we have been prepared to be able to face adversities. We have been prepared to face suffering. We have been made to believe that suffering is a very normal, natural part of growing up. What if that's not true? What if suffering and your subscription to suffering is only delaying your actualization? This is the thought I want to leave you with. Thank you very much for listening to me.